Hello there. Good morning, afternoon or night or whenever it is you're watching this. This is a video of two halves. First half is me in a local field for an hour or so, not finding too much but having some nice deep digs with the Etrac. Second part is me and a friend called Dan who went out to a coin shooting site that I considered to be pretty much worked out. It turned out to be anything but worked out. And we had, you'll see it. It's really strange what we found, and the ratio of one thing to another just didn't match up with what we normally had. It was a great hunt. I was using the Etrac with an 18-inch coil. Dan was using the Deus with a 9-inch coil. Now Dan's actually considering buying either the Etrac or the Deus. So I've been out with him before on a different site, and he used both machines. This time he only used the Deus. I was prepared to let him use the Etrac whenever he wanted, but he never asked for it. He was happy with what he was getting with the Deus. And he was digging some very deep holes for some great finds. Now the second hunt is about 3 hours long, and when you see what we found within that 3 hours, it's pretty phenomenal really, from a site that I've absolutely bashed over the years. Everything just seemed to go right. It was great. In the end of the video, I'm going to be giving away these pocket put and takes, which were featured in my last video when I went to visit a fella called Gary, who's another great friend of mine, who actually makes these in a trench art style. He's made these out of coins that I've found, so stay tuned for the end of the video where I'll be giving these fellas away, and I've worked out a very fair way to do it. Now in this dig, I've gone down probably is about 10 or more inches to where this thing is, and it looks like it's some lead object, possibly a musket ball, right in the middle of the screen there. So as I'm handheld, I'm going to dig it out and then show you what it is. Yep, it's definitely a musket ball. See how deep that is? Quite a big lump of lead, and it did give a very erratic signal, but that has to be a good, well, I don't know, 9-10 inches? Yeah, 9 inches maybe. The probe's roughly 9 inches long. Still a good old depth under rocks to pull out a bit of lead. Definitely close to it now, and it's a coin. Looks like a half penny. It is a half penny. See if I can get a date on it. 1872, and it seems to be in pretty good condition as well. Yeah, it's got quite a lot of crud on it, but that looks like a pretty nicely conditioned Bunhead Victoria half penny from 1872. World's worst nightmare. Another bloody spade bites the dust. What this deep digging does to them. God damn. Well, I've gone down approximately, I don't know, 7-8 inches with a broken spade, and I've managed to find, I think, another coin. Yep. That one looks quite a bit older. It's very knackered. I don't think I'm going to get a date off that. Might even be a flat one. Yep, looks pretty featureless to me. And the beauty of detecting near home is, come back, there's always a spade lying round in the garden. That'll do. Another nice deep hole for 1 fat coin or a button. A button which has been crushed beyond belief. Although it has got a bugle on there and a crown. Right, I've got a signal here. It was quite hard to pinpoint, and it was reading 1233 on the Etrac. It's obviously fairly small because it's keeping itself hidden within this ball. I thought it was like a Roman coin, a very small one called a minim,
I think it's quite small enough for a minimum though, and it's got a hole in the middle, so it's pretty much just a washer. Looks like another musket ball, except this one is a little pistol musket ball. Tiny one. Oh no, it's not. It's got a hole through it. It's a fishing weight. Another mighty deep hole. Four. For something or other. For quite an interesting artifact. Not sure what that is. Looks quite well made though. It seems to have like six sides, a point on the top. I don't know whether that maybe's had a screw on. Could be a finial of some sort. That was a lovely deep dig. By God, it gave a good signal. Excellent. Hopefully this'll be the little musket ball I was after. Yes, I think it is. Yep, it's definitely been pressed. You can see the ridge going around the side of it there. Little musket ball, it's almost exactly the same size as that fishing weight I found just a minute ago. Well, that's exactly as dug, and I can see something in there. That looks like copper. It's a hell of a depth. Oh man, just blank. I thought it might have been a hammered copper coin. Nah, it's just blank. It may still have been a coin, possibly a Roman one, although it doesn't look very thick. Not going to get anything off that one, but it gave a reasonable signal, down about 4 or 5 inches. This one was a lovely clean sounding 1235 on the Etrac, and I've got a little coin ball here. I'm kind of hoping it's a sixpence or something, but it might not be. It isn't. What is it? It looks like a button. Do you know, I was convinced that was a coin. Gave a lovely signal. There's Dan over there using the Deus. He's already found a half penny. I haven't found anything yet, but this looks like a coin ball. Hopefully it'll be a good find. It's a coin. Nothing spectacular, but it's a half penny from George V. This was a slightly trickier signal. It was bouncing all over the place. And it looks like a button. Yep, little button. This one was reading as, I think, 1235. And we appear to have silver. Get in there. George V, sixpence. 1921. It's got a little bit of tarnish on, but that'll soon come up, and that's a lovely conditioned sixpence. Give a great signal as well. Reading 1235. Now this one was reading 1238, and there's something in here, which I hope is a coin. It was a lovely, sweet signal. So you know I'm hoping it's silver, but I don't think it will be. Will it, hell? And it's not even a coin. It's a button. That gave an absolutely unbelievable signal. It was probably about 6-7 inches down. Just had a shout of silver from Dan, so we're going to go and see what he's found. Show me the money!
1944, isn't it? Silver, half silver?
Well, it's 50% silver. Shilling. Get in there. I found a sixpence up there as well. That's in cracking condition.
It is.
Scottish one with a lion on.
Marvellous.
When was a 1921 sixpence?
It was deep, that as well. Like, I was impressed with that.
How deep was it? Took some finding, I see.
Well, it was right at the bottom of there, though, and it's still done.
It's a good, I don't know, 7-8 inches?
So what's up?
Really, that's 9.
That's
aye. It's a, good depth. Did it give a good signal as
brilliant
well?
Brilliant as well. Really clear.
It's hellish, man. Hellish. You know, we've only been in, what, 20 minutes? And we found two silvers. There's still stuff here, you know. There could be anything here. It's incredible. Another signal. This one was reading 1037. And it's a ship half penny. Date is 1941. And that's George the Sixth. It's kind of old depth again. And it gave a pretty good signal on the E-track. Ah, there we go. Interesting to see how old this was, because it's a hell of a depth. By the misshape and nature of it, and the size of it, I would say it was a Georgian halfpenny. But that's another totally blank one. Still gave a good signal though, and it was down... 8-9 inches. It's an old penny from about 8 or 9 inches down. And it looks flat. Yep, another flat one. God. Give a good signal though. Wow, it's got a lovely black patina on it, that, hasn't it? It's as black as the night is long.
That's not the sixpence.
No, that's not the sixpence. Nice one. 1943. Good nick as well. Mine had that sort of rusty sort of stain on as well, you know. But that'll come off, like a bit of baking soda. Another one from quite deep, and that one is actually sitting on end. Another penny, and it does appear to have a little bit of detail on that one. Just about make out Britannia there. And it looks like a young head Victoria, so that's 1800s. This was a very bouncy signal, and by the looks of that, it probably is about 7-8 inches down. And what the heck's that? I thought it was a musket ball. It possibly is, like a flattened musket ball. I found a few musket balls in here of this sort of size, like Civil War sort of size. Possibly a flattened musket ball. This was a decent signal, reading 1022. And it's a modern 10 pence. This is before they went really small. So that was just lying on the top?
Just under the tree.
Tell it's been in the air for a while, like that colour on it. Another George the Sixpence.
Shining up when I get to it.
Oh, it'll come up nicely. It's seven. Seven silvers.
Aye.
This was a Titanic dig, this one. Oh, God. Well, it is just a half penny. It's quite a modern one as well. Well, there seems to have been something else in that hole as well. Come on, silver. Come on, silver. Howie. Howie. It's a threepenny bit from, I think, 1947. Now, I don't believe this. I had a reading of between 135 and 140 on the E-track. Very faint signal, difficult to pinpoint. And I've just pulled up three sixpences out of the same hole at a depth of nearly 12 inches. It was an absolutely incredible depth. What a find. Excellent. Get in there. That was an absolutely crazy hunt. We were only out for about 3 hours. And I think in that particular field, we found more silver than copper, which is a phenomenal return. We found seven silver coins between us and only about four or five coppers in that field. So that was a great hunt. And Dan loved it. He actually found one right on the top as well, that one right at the end. So it just shows what's there. There's hellish mole activity there. So 6 months ago, when I hit that area fairly hard, a lot of the stuff might have been out of reach. The moles tend to bring stuff up to the top, and we just hit very lucky on that day. It was a great day. Right, now it's time to give these away.
Right, now with these put and takes, there's one from 1945 and there's two from 1914. So they both match in with the World Wars. I'm going to do the 1945 first, followed by the 1914s. And instead of asking you to comment on this particular video where I'm giving the stuff away, I'm actually going to go back to the previous video about the trench art, and everybody who commented in that video up to this point will have a chance of winning these. I'm basically just going to skip through them without looking at them, and wherever the cursor lands, where I take my hand off the pad, that's who will win it. I think that's the fairest way to do it. I didn't want to put a special video out specifically for these, because then it's not rewarding the people who liked that trench art video. Now, for anybody who missed that last video, which was about trench art and where I visited the fella who actually makes these out of the coins, this was made out of coins that I found in the fields. I took them up to Gary and he cleaned them up and made them into replica trench art. You've got a put and take game in here, where you basically spin this and do whatever it says on it. That wasn't a very good spin. I'm actually right-handed and this is my left hand. I'll use my right hand. There you go, you would spin that on a table. It would land on something. Put two, so you'd put two coins in the middle, pass it on to the next person. They would spin it, say it landed on take two. They would take two away, put one, take all. Take all is winning the game. You can also put matches in here as well, the striker on the side. These were actually originally made in the First World War in exactly the same way as Gary makes them. So this is a real homage to those fellas who fought and died in the First and Second World War. Here's all the comments on the trench art video. I've brought them all up by pressing show more. There you go. Trench art. So what I'm going to do is just skim through them, pressing up, down, up, down, up, 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 down, and wherever the cursor lands, that's who gets the prize. Right, this is the 1945 one. Here we go, and stop. Right, where is it? That's it. Up there. Slick digs. Bah, so I'll just zoom in on that so you can see. Slick digs. If you're watching this video, or if anybody who knows Slick Digs is watching this video, just send me a message with your address and I'll send you that out. No bother. I think you're in America, but it's no problem sending it out. Okay, the next one is a 1914 put and take. So one down, two to go. Right. Where are we now? Oh man, we're over there. God damn it. I'll go straight across. Rollo F. Nichols, or Roloff Nichols. Just zoom in on that so you can see it. There you go. If you are Roloff Nichols, or you know Roloff Nichols, tell him to send a message to me with his address, and I shall send him a 1914 trench art put and take. And the last one is another 1914 put and take. So here we go. I'm actually just watching this on the camcorder screen. That way I can check the screen's still moving, but I can't see whose thing's coming up. Seems to be working reasonably well. Okay, and stop. Oh, right down at the bottom. That one is Malcolm Billing. There you go, Malcolm Billing. That prize is yours. If you send me your address, I'll send it out to you. If you're not watching and anybody knows Malcolm, just send him a message. Get him to message me with an address and I'll send that out for him. Now, my previous video about the trench art, I did express an opinion about grave robbers and dishonesty and so on and such forth. That gathered a few more dislikes than normal. Obviously people don't agree with me. I still stand by what I said. There are some people out there who are total scumbags. The majority of people agree with me, and that's great. Absolutely spot on. I probably lost a few subscribers through that because people like to see people robbing graves and behaving like a-holes. We'll not be doing that. And on the subject of war medals and getting them back to the relatives, I heard a great story. It was actually on Facebook. A fella called Mick Finders Keepers, who has a channel on YouTube, has just got an old medal back to the family. So I'll put a link for his channel in the video description. He's a cracking fella for doing that, and that's exactly what should happen. So there you go. If you're one of the winners, send me a message with your address and I shall send you your prize out anywhere in the world at my expense. And I realise at least one of you is in America. I'm just glad all three aren't in Australia. Thanks for watching.